Good afternoon, everyone. So welcome to our tutorial on healthcare data mining with matrix models. And supposedly, we have three presenters, me, Ping, and Joe. But unfortunately, because of some family reasons, Joe cannot be here. So me and Ping are going to be in charge of the presentation. And I'm going to present the first part, and then we're going to have a coffee break, and then Ping is going to present the second part. So a brief introduction. So I am, my name is Fei Wang, and I am currently a faculty member in Division of Health Informatics in Department of Healthcare Policy and Research in Yale Cornell. I'm going to introduce in the first part some of the popular matrix models that we have been adapted or applied in solving different kinds of healthcare problems in recent years. And in the second half, Ping is going to give you some more concrete case studies. So I always start with this page, which is a problem that why everybody now is keen working on healthcare is because there's a lot of money that is not wisely spent in healthcare, and potentially we can save a lot of money and improve the quality of care delivery a lot. So as data mining folks, we of course are interested in to find out whether we can dig some insights from the healthcare data to see whether those insights can help us to save the cost and improve the quality. So what kind of healthcare data we have been working in recent years, right? So for myself, the majority part of my work has been analyzing electronic health records from different clinical institutions, hospitals, medical schools, and even from industries. So if you Google electronic health records, there are different kinds of definitions. And this is a definition I copied from that Nature Review Genetics article. So it's a systematic collection of electronic health information of individual or population patients. So information included in HR, here are some examples like drug, like lab tests, medical imaging sometimes. Although, I mean, I don't have any work on analyzing medical imaging so far. I mainly analyze structured EHR, and there are also unstructured parts. So I collaborated with the natural language processing guys, so they help us to structuralize the unstructured part of EHR and combine it with the structured part, and which can be later on feed into the computational models like prediction models or clustering models and whatever. So that's the EHR, and also medical imaging is important. There are tons of works, especially in data mining, machine learning, fMRI, MRI, so on and so forth. And also I drug data, like this is a chemical structure of the drug, and also protein target. What are the targets of the drug, and also genetic information. Although, I mean, we have fairly limited databases that include both clinical and genetic information, like the Cancer Genome Atlas, TCGA data. But with the arrival of the precision medicine era, so this kinds of combination of clinical and genetic information will become more and more common and more important. So physiology data, I think if you work, you have worked with the MIT MIMIC data, in ICU setting typically, I mean, you're gonna have a lot of physiological signals. And also patient survey, I mean, a lot of information are not captured in EHR. Let's say environmental information, daily activity information or whatever. So one of the recent projects we have been working on is the World Trade Center data set. So they have tracked a certain population of patients or people who have witnessed the crash of the World Trade Center from 9/11, and they track those people and doing survey, I think, every 3 years to see what could be the important factors to affect their mental status. So there are lots of comprehensive information not included in, let's say, EHR or clinical information. And also online social media, which is more and more common and more popular, not just medical related forum, like patient like me, MedHelp, but also people ask questions, let's say, on Facebook, on Twitter. People search health-related questions on, let's say, Microsoft Bing or Google. Those are all resources that we could potentially utilize to perform healthcare analytics, right? And also environmental data. Some certain kinds of disease, let's say COPD, chronic obstructive pulmonary disease, could be affected by air pollution. So in certain region in this world, if we have the information on the air quality, that could be something unique to study the progression of COPD with the effect of those environmental factors. And this is a figure I borrowed from my friend Nigam Shah's from Stanford, his slide. So basically, we have all different kinds of information, and we want to dig insights from those all different kinds of data to answer clinical questions, build predictive models to improve the quality of healthcare. So there are tons of computational models. We do data mining, we know. We have association rule mining, we have optimization, we have a causal inference, we have optimization, whatever. So today, I mean, we are specifically focusing on one type of computational model, which is matrix. I think before matrix, I think a more common or simplified input format is the vectors. I think even now, still most of the works we have seen so far in healthcare informatics or healthcare analytics assumes the input is in terms of vectors, right? So the typical way we construct a vector for every patient. A typical way to construct that is you first define what are the dimensions of the vectors. Let's say we usually call them features. Let's say it could be a certain type of diagnosis. And then we specify a certain time period, which is the observation window, let's say over 1 year. For each of the ICD-9 code, the ICD-9 stands for International Classification of Disease, the ninth version. So it includes all the different kinds of disease conditions. So you just account for each of the disease conditions, how many times or the frequency it appears within this 1 year. So basically, you got a profile, let's say, diagnosis profile for every patient. So for each disease condition, what is the frequency it appears in this year, right? And then it is like a bag of words representation for documents. And then you can, let's say, predict. Let's say if we want to do some prediction, I mean, based on those diagnosis profile, what could be the possibility or the risk that this patient gonna have, let's say, a certain type of disease or death after half a year or something like that. So that's a typical way we work in the past. But this vector-based representation one, I mean, because you just have a vector, so it cannot encode more, I mean, or too much information. So let's say in this case, if we aggregated the diagnosis code into bag of codes representation, then what you lose is the temporal dependency between, I mean, those the ordering of those of the appearance of those diagnosis codes, which could be very important, right? Especially because every disease is progressing over time, and you basically ignore all the time information that could be very important. So matrices, you can think of it as some richer form of vectors. So you add another dimension into vectors, then you got a matrix. So in one of my, I think it cropped. The resolution is not correct. So I have reference at the bottom, but you cannot see it. So in one of my early, I think 2012 KDD papers, so we claimed that instead of representing patient as vectors, we can represent the patient as matrices where the vertical axis is still different kinds of features, but the horizontal axis is the time. So basically, you have a dot or you have one. If this specific, these are different kinds of features. CPT stands for concurrent procedure terminology, which is a procedure code, right? Lab is different kinds of lab tests. PCP, and primary care physician and specialist are standing for different kinds of visit, right? So basically, if you observe one specific feature, which is, in this case, this specific procedure at this specific day, you will have a dot there. So we got a matrix representation of the patients. The good thing about this is you can capture the time. You can think of the bag of words representation we just talked about is basically you do a roll sum of this matrix, right? So now we expand that. So you can see where and when this event is observed so that you can capture the temporal dependency, but the potential problem could be the matrix will be very, very sparse, okay? So another structure that is naturally associated with matrices is a graph, right? So this is a graph. So a graph is composed of two sets of elements. One is an edge. One is a set of nodes. One is a set of edges, right? And each graph could be corresponding to a what we call this adjacency matrix, right? If this graph is undirected, let's say a lot of the time we work with similarity graph. Similarity graph means that you put an edge between a pair of nodes if you think they are similar. And the weight on the edge could be the similarity between the pair of nodes, right? And then the similarity graph is, of course, undirected because the similarity between I and J is, of course, the same as the similarity between J and I. There could be directed graph, right, if you study the browsing behavior of, let's say, a user on the surfing on the internet, right? You click this first and then click the second and click the third. So if you want to capture the ordering, this person click those different web pages, it will be directed, right? So this is an undirected graph, and this is the its associated adjacency matrix where we assume it is unweighted. So we put a 1 if there is an edge, or we put a 0 if there's no edges. And this graph type of analysis is very important and also a very popular type of method in medical analysis. This is because graphs are very interpretable. Let's say if you apply an SVM and you train it, and if you present the result to a doctor, the doctor asks you, what does those W mean? The coefficient of that W means, it will be very hard to interpret. But the graph, you can always draw it, right? So it is highly interpretable and very popular. So I will introduce some works later on. We use that to do, let's say, this is symptom expansion and patient similarity evaluation. And also, we look for patterns in a graph. So because of the natural correlations, or correspondence between the graph and matrices, or networks and matrices, so I summarized until now, I mean, from my own perspective, the popular research problems in medical or health informatics in a network way. So basically, because we are going to work with, doesn't matter what we work on, but we want to, our center is the patients, right? So we put patients in the center. So basically, you have a patient network where the nodes are the patients and the edges are the similarities between pairwise patients. So you have a patient graph. And of course, how to estimate the clinical similarity or in a more comprehensive way, not necessarily clinical similarity, the general similarity between pairwise patients would be an important research topic. There are a lot of papers in recent years. I myself also write quite a few papers on this topic. So similarly, I mean, around the patients, you're going to have different kinds of informations. We can call them auxiliary graphs. Let's say we have drug graph, right? Medication is important in how to evaluate the similarity between pairwise drugs is also important. Ping has a lot of works on this. And also, we have a disease. Again, I'm sorry, you cannot see it. The disease graph, right? And also, let's say, gene graph, and so on and so forth. Those are just examples of those auxiliary domains. And estimating the weights on the edges are always important. It doesn't matter in which domain. So you can check. There are papers on assessing disease similarities, papers assessing the similarity, constructing gene networks. I mean, within network similarities are important, but also cross-network links are also important. Let's say we always talk about, I mean, in the past we talked about personalized medicine, now we talk about precision medicine. So it's basically, can you tailor down the treatment to individual patients, right? Recommend the right patient to, I mean, the right drug, right treatment to the right patient at the right time. That's a precision medicine problem. So you want to estimate the link between the drug and the patients. And also, if you want to do risk prediction, can you tell me what is the, based on the records of the, current records of the patients, can you predict after, let's say, half a year, what is the risk that this patient gonna have heart failure? So this is basically, you want to predict you want to estimate the links between the patients and the diseases, right? And also, we have DNA sequencing, those kind of stuff, which is estimating the missing links between the patients and the genes. This one, that is a gene. I'm sorry, you cannot see it. I mean, the resolution seems there's, it cropped my, the bottom part of the slides. So this is disease, this is a gene. Yeah. And also, the links between the auxiliary domains are also important. Let's say we're gonna, this drug repurposing or drug repositioning is an important problem that the goal is to predict, I mean, for the drugs already on the market, what could be the other diseases? Every drug has a therapeutic indication, right? But what could be other potential diseases that this drug can be targeted to? Because if you identify that, that's going to save compared to develop or manufacture a drug from scratch, this is going to save a lot of money and time for the pharma. So I think Ping going to give you some concrete examples on this. And also, I'm sorry, this is a disease gene association study. So with precision medicine, this becomes more and more important. What are the genes that is responsible for this kind of disease? And also drug target interaction prediction. What is the target of this drug, something like that. So all these are popular research problems in recent years in health or medical informatics, and we can basically, I just summarize that from in a network way. So Those are the basic introductions. I introduce network here is because there is a natural relationship between networks and matrices, right? So let's see. I'm going to introduce some popular matrix methods that has been applied or adapted a lot in solving medical problems. Specifically, I'm going to introduce spectral clustering, label propagation, and matrix factorization. So let's first see spectral clustering. I think a lot of you may already be very familiar with this. So spectral clustering is, from its name, it's basically a set of algorithms that can, first, it do cluster. It do clustering, right? Second, it uses spectrum. So algorithm that cluster points using the eigenvectors of the matrices derived from the data. And usually, especially if you want to do a multi-class clustering, it obtains data representation in lower dimensional space that can be easily clustered, which means that if you have experience with spectral clustering, it typically works in two steps, right? In the first step, you obtain a low dimensional embedding. The second step, you run k-means. You can also do recursive by partitioning. That's different ways of doing that. So there are a variety. It is not one algorithm. It is a set of algorithms for spectral clustering. You can use the spectrum or eigenvectors or eigenvalues of different kinds of matrices. It is not that straightforward compared to hierarchical clustering or k-means, okay? So in order to introduce spectral clustering, so we need to first introduce some basic knowledge of graphs. So a graph I have introduced is tuple of vertex set and edge set. So if for each element in the edge set, Eij belongs to E, if it is a directed graph, then the pair Eij would be ordered. So point from Vi to Vj. If it is undirected, then it doesn't matter. So a specific type of graph, which is called a bipartite graph. We also talk a lot because a lot of the times you have more than one category of nodes in the graph. Let's say you have patients and diseases, right? So if you only care about the links between patients and disease, you don't have links within the patients, and you don't have the link within the diseases, then this is usually called a bipartite graph, right? If you have, let's say, three domains, you only have, let's say you have patients and you have disease and you have a drug, then you can also construct a tripartite graph. So for most of the graph we talked about, or if you talk to somebody, we are working on graphs, we typically refer to a flat graph. So a flat graph means that you only link pairwise nodes, right? That is the most, the impression for most of people what the graph looks like, but it is not necessary, right? You can have every edge links, an arbitrary number of nodes, more than two. So in that case, you basically come up with a hypergraph. So a flat graph or a pairwise graph is a special case of the hypergraph. So we just talk about a flat graph here. Similarity graph. So it is basically, as I just explained, so you put an edge between a pair of nodes if you think they are similar, and the weight on the edge is basically the similarity between a pair of nodes. And the similarity graph is, of course, symmetric. Undirected, and the adjacency matrix is symmetric. So graph partitioning corresponds to a clustering problem. If you want to cut the graph into two parts or three parts, every part, which is a subgraph, is basically a cluster of the data set. So the partitioning criterion, I mean, the most straightforward way is basically you look for the cut that has a minimum cost. So what is the cost? So here is basically you look for a set of edges. So the weight of the edges, if you sum up them together, will be the smallest, right? So let's say in this case you have, because the edges corresponding to, I mean the weight on the edge corresponds to the similarity. So a smaller weight means that less similarity between the nodes. So you look for, I mean, the edge with smaller weights to cut, which means that you look for the most dissimilar pair of nodes to cut. So you got more separated data clusters. So that's what we, the most straightforward way to do a graph cut. Or we usually call this a min cut, right? You look for a set of edges that this can be viewed as the cost of the cut, right? You want to cut it into two parts. One is A, one is B, the two parts are disjoint. They cannot be overlapped. And you look for a set of edge weights that connecting the two parts in the most loose way, right? But the problem of min cut is it is sensitive to outliers. Let's say if you have an outlier which has a very small weight links itself with some node in a majority part of the data cloud, then the most effective way, or if you solve this min cut problem, is to cut this node off with the other parts. So basically that is meaningless because that is not what we want. So later on people want to improve this min cut. So they want to achieve, we know if you work on clustering balancing is an important factor. So basically we want to get a graph cut. I mean, not only minimize the cut cost, but also the number of nodes within each part after cut should be comparable to each other. So that's a balanced cut. So, and then later on people propose this normalized cut. So you can do two types of normalized cut, right? The most straightforward way is you put the cardinality of each part in a denominator. And this is another way, which is a more popular way. So instead of put the cardinality resultant part, you put the volume. The volume is basically all, you sum up all the weights of the edges in that subgraph. That's the volume. So this normalized cut becomes very popular. I think this is proposed in 2000. I think it's first published in CVPR, and the application is image segmentation. Later on, they published a paper in PAMI, which got very highly cited from Jethro Malik's group. So a spectral graph theory is basically you represent a similarity graph and then you construct some sort of matrices I will introduce later on. And then you do eigenvalue decomposition, and then you got the eigenvectors, and then you derive the clusters from that. So what is the relationship between this and the graph cut? Actually, if you read that PAMI paper, 2000, this is just a normalized cut and image segmentation, that's the title. I mean, they have a step-by-step derivation mathematically. So how this normalized cut can later on be equivalent to a eigenvalue decomposition problem. So I'm not going to introduce that in detail here, but if you're interested, you can read that paper. So the general steps are, first, you construct a weighted adjacency matrix from your graph, And then, I mean, there are different ways of constructing. In the second step, you're going to construct a certain type of matrix, and then you do eigenvalue decomposition. But different methods construct different matrices. For example, Minkot, in the second step, they construct this degree matrix. This degree matrix is basically you sum up, you do a row sum of the W matrix and then put the row sum on the diagonal line, which is a degree matrix, and then you construct this Laplacian matrix, which is D minus W. This Laplacian matrix is positive semi-definite, and it always have a zero eigenvalue because you do a row sum, and if you come up with a vector with all the elements equal to one, it's always the eigenvector of this Laplacian matrix with associated eigenvalue zero. So, but all other eigenvalues of Laplacian matrix is positive. So it is positive semi-definite. And then if you do a eigenvalue decomposition of D minus W and use the eigenvector of this associated with the second smallest, because the smallest is zero, we don't want to use that. Use the second smallest eigenvector, and then it will be like that. Let me see. It will be like that. You use the second eigenvector. You can see, I mean, the first three values are positive. The second three values are negative. So you can use that as what you did in SVM. So the first part corresponds to cluster one. The second part corresponds to cluster two. That is basically 1, 2, 3. Cluster 1, 4, 5, 6, cluster 2, that is equivalent to what you did for minkot. And normalized cut is, instead of doing eigenvalue decomposition on regular Laplacian matrix, they first do this symmetric normalization, and then do eigenvalue decomposition on this matrix and use the eigenvector of the second smallest eigenvalue to do, if you want to do by partitioning, right? Partition it into two parts. So that's the basic step. You first, pre-processing, you first construct the matrix representation, and then you do eigenvalue decomposition. If you want to, if you just do a by partitioning, then you just use a one eigenvector. If you want to do more, let's say, multi-class partitioning, let's say if you want to cluster them into three, clusters, what can you do is you use the eigenvectors corresponding to the second and third smallest eigenvalue and treat them as the two-dimensional embedding of your original data set and then run a k-means on top of that. So there are also other ways, but that's the popular way. And one way, we compute, So one way to compute the similarity is you use a Gaussian function. So because we always have a vector representation of the data, so how can you need to first come up with a similarity matrix, right? So how can we compute that? A popular way is to use a Gaussian function. So basically you put the Euclidean distance, divided by a certain variance and put, take a negative and put it on the shoulder of exponential. So basically, larger Euclidean distance will result in a smaller value on that Gaussian function, so which means that larger distance corresponds to small similarity. So that's a popular way, but people usually set up a unique sigma. Because in Gaussian function, you have a sigma on the denominator of the shoulder of exponential. They set up a unique sigma for the entire data set. So that sigma is magic, which means that if you tune that into different values, your result is going to be very different. So this is an example. So in order to make the sigma less sensitive or make our tuning process easier. So there is one NIPS paper in 2004 proposed this local scaling schema. So instead of use one unique sigma for the entire data set. They use different sigmas for different data pairs, and that, let's say xi and xj, they use sigma and sigma I and sigma j, and sigma I and sigma j are just the median distance of this data point to its neighborhood, to its k nearest neighborhood. So, and they show that this can make the result a lot less sensitive to the choice of sigma. And this can, you can see this is like normalize the density of the distribution of the data around each data point. So they show that there are a lot of improvement. And spectral clustering is one type of unsupervised learning method. So we know that unsupervised learning is typically, it is good because you don't need any supervision, which means that it can save money and time, because supervision, you need to ask an expert to provide, and you need to spend money. Depends on your, especially in medical or health applications, if you ask a doctor to help you label the data, that would be very costly. So, but the other aspect of unsupervised learning is that if you have a sufficiently large data set, that is good. If you don't have as many data as you can get, then, I mean, the result of the unsupervised learning could be not reliable, because the data could be noisy. The data, I mean, there could be wrong message conveyed in the data. So a more popular way or a common way is to work in a semi-supervised setting. So which means that you still use, doesn't matter how much data you have, you use all of them. But you can have a supervision information on a very small portion of the data. That supervision could be in terms of labels or in terms of different kinds of constraints. So that is what we call this semi-supervised setting. So you have a large data set, only a small portion of them you have supervision information. So can you infer, let's say, the label, depends on what you are working on, of the rest of the data points that do not have supervision information, right? That's a semi-supervised setting. And in spectral clustering, there is, I mean, there are a whole bunch of people work on constraint clustering. And also, there is one work called constraint spectral clustering, which is proposed by Professor Ian Davidson from UC Davis. This is KDD 2010. So let's say, I mean, they consider one certain type of constraints, which is a must link or cannot link. This is very popular, and it used to be called side information, I think, in one of Professor Eric Xing's paper in NIPS 2, I mean, I forgot, very early 2000 or something. So, which means that you don't care the exact label of the data points. You just care about whether, if you are given a data pair, whether this pair of data belong to the same class, which is a must link, or they should belong to different class, which suggests a cannot link, right? You have this kinds of constraint on a certain percentage, a small portion of the data. So they constructed a fitness measure, so which stands for, let's say you first constructed this Q matrix, which is a constraint matrix, which is square. If you have n data samples, it will be n by n. So Qij equals 1 if there is a must link between them, Qij equals minus 1 if there is a cannot link between them. And then let's come up with a cluster assignment vector. Let's say if we just care about binary clustering. So Ui equals 1 if this data point belongs to cluster 1. Ui equals minus 1 if this data point belongs to cluster minus 1. So if you do this U transpose Qu, it comes up with a measure. So basically, if Qij equals 1, which means that there is a mass link between them. And Qi and Qj, they have the same psi, which means that they belong to either the same class. I mean, they either belong to the positive cluster or they both belong to the negative cluster. Then you have a positive value in the summation, right? If Qi, I mean, if this term has a negative value, which means that Qij equals 1, but Qi and Qj, they are not in, they do not have the same psi, which means there might be an error, right? Or Qij equals minus 1, which means that there is a cannot link, but Ui and Uj, they belong to the same cluster, which means that there might also be an error. So the bigger the value of this one, the more consistent your partition will be with respect to the set of constraints, right? So they modified the normalized cut or mean cut. What they modified is a normalized cut by adding up this constraint. So which means that they want the consistency to be above a certain threshold, right? They want your predicted label to be consistent with the set of constraints, right? And they solve that, and they call this constraint a spectral clustering. So they do not do a purely unsupervised spectral clustering, but they also want the result to be consistent with your initial constraints. And they applied, this is a recent paper, this is a 2016 paper. Yep. Yep. I and itself? Yes, I mean, there are different ways. I saw sometimes people put 1 on the diagonal line, but most commonly people put 0 on the diagonal line. Yeah, I mean, I saw both ways. I also did experiment with either you set it to 1 or 0. It, I mean, did not matter too much. I think it also depends on your data. Yeah, but most of the time, if 0 means that you don't put a self loop, right? So you put, I suggest you put 0. Yeah. So I think this year they wrote a paper applying this constraint spectral clustering to this study, this mild traumatic brain injury, which is a common problem for, the soldiers. So they collected the data, I mean, electronic health data from the CRCC for the soldiers who served in Afghanistan and from 2008 to 2012. And they studied symptomology. So let's say a headache, it becomes, they want to predict it becomes worse or better after they take certain drugs, right? They use the drugs as the features and certain neurology assessment as the features to predict whether this symptom gonna become better or no. And they predict, these are the different kinds of symptoms, dizziness, fatigue, headache, hearing, whatever. And these are the different kinds of methodologies that they compare with. I think they use 2/3 of the data for training and for these supervised methods. For training and 1/3 for testing and for constraint spectral clustering, I think they label 50% of the patients and transform them into a pair of constraints, and this is the result. So you can see, I mean, this transductive, we already call this in the transductive setting. I mean, this transductive method performs better than pure supervised methods when you don't have enough labeled data, okay? So that's spectral clustering. Actually, this is just one example. There are more examples. I think the spectral clustering is widely used in a lot of bioinformatics problems. I just give you one recent example where this is applied in a clinical problem, right? So, evaluation metric, this is the accuracy, I believe. Because they want to predict, let's say, this balance is becoming better or worse. So this is a binary classification problem. Yeah. I think for this, they did not discriminate that. Because what they want to do, they just extract, I think you can read the paper. They just extract all the MTBI patients and then study whether the symptom is becoming better or not. They don't predict whether it will become PTSD or something like that. Yeah. Other questions? I will upload the tutorial slides to my website later on if you want to dig it further, because you cannot see the bottom part, where I put the references in. So that's spectral clustering. Any other questions? If no, I'm going to proceed with the second part. So the second part I want to introduce is label propagation. So label propagation, this is a graph created by my friend Hang Hang. So label propagation is like you drop a spill of wine on a cloth and it will diffuse. So on a graph, this cloth is like the graph. And let's say if initially you have label just on node one and you want to propagate this label to the rest of the nodes along this graph. So that's the process. So some notations, initially we denote the initial label as y, so y1 equals 1, and y others equals 0, right? And this is a propagation rule, so every step it retains a certain percentage of information of its initial label. You don't want to completely throw that at the same time you do a absorbing. This is like every step, t plus one, this is node I, the predicted label of node I, gonna absorb the label information from last step, which is step j, from its neighborhood. So j tilde I, which means that there is the edge linking node j and node I, right? And this absorbing is in a linear way, right? You do a linear combination, and combination coefficient is the weight on the edges, right? And so when you do the propagation, it is like, because at the first step, just the node 2 and 3 linking links with node 1, so node 2 and 3 gonna receive some label information at the first step. And in the second step, node 4 and 9 links node 2 and 3, so 4 and 9 gonna receive some label information at the same time. The label information contained in node 1, 2, 3 is going to still propagate. So it does not like it received label information, then it stopped. No, it will still propagate. So same thing for the other nodes. So after three steps, all the nodes are going to receive some label information, and this propagation process is going to continue until it converges. So the question we have is, of course, this is a matrix form, right? If you concatenate all the FIs as a vector and all the edge weights as a matrix, which is a weighted adjacency matrix, right? So this is a matrix form. So the question is, of course, is process going to converge or no? If it does not converge, then this process is useless. So this is a propagation rule. This is the initial status. First step, second step, third step. If you do an induction, this is after t steps. So our problem is when t becomes infinite, will there be a limit of this expression or no, right? So because alpha is a trade-off parameter between the absorbing part and the retaining part, right? So it is between 0 and 1. So when t becomes infinite, this term is going to be 0, of course. And the problem is, whether this part gonna have a limit or no when t becomes infinite. So it can be shown that if the spectral radius of w, which is the largest eigenvalue of w, is no larger than 1, this term gonna converge to this. So now, I mean, our problem becomes how can we guarantee the spectral radius of w is no larger than 1, right? So there is a theorem tells us that if w is a stochastic matrix, then, I mean, this condition is satisfied. So what is a stochastic matrix? So the most common way, so if you know Markov chain, so the transition matrix between pairwise states is a stochastic matrix. So let's say initially you come up with a general graph affinity or similarity matrix, and then you do a raw normalization, you divide every element by its row sum, then you got a stochastic matrix, right? This is a matrix form. And but the problem is that if you do this raw normalization, then because initially W12 equals W21, you divided W12 by D1, but you divide W21 by D2, then this matrix will no longer be symmetric, right? Then, I mean, which means that after this normalization, the similarity matrix is no longer symmetric. So, which is hard to interpret. So, we want to seek for a stochastic matrix, which is symmetric, right? So, then we Google. So, on Wiki, there are three types of stochastic matrices. So, one is right stochastic matrix, we just talked about, which is not symmetric. One is left stochastic matrix. Instead of divide every element by the row sum, you divide every element by the column sum. So you suffer from the same asymmetry problem, right? So the third kind of stochastic matrix is this bi or doubly stochastic matrix, which is symmetric stochastic matrix with both row and column sum equal to 1. So this looks like what we want, right? So now the problem becomes, because both right stochastic and left stochastic matrix is very easy to get. But how, if we are initially given a similarity matrix, how can we get a bi or doubly stochastic version of that, right? So there is a simple procedure. So you first do raw normalization, and then you do column normalization, and then you do raw normalization again, and you do this alternatively, you will find out it will finally converge. And the converged solution is a doubly stochastic matrix of W, so which is a simple but very interesting process. And I analyzed this procedure before, and I published a paper in 2010, ICDM. I find out that what this procedure did is actually you look for a doubly stochastic matrix that is closest to your initial matrix. From a certain perspective, that perspective is called Kullback labeler divergence. So basically, you want to find a doubly stochastic matrix that is closest to your initial matrix under KL divergence, which is of course not necessary. So I extend to Bregman divergence, and we gave several concrete instantiations, like what if your loss is Frobenius norm instead of KL divergence. And now, I mean, we use, there are a lot of works published papers between me and Ping, and we use this kinds of, if we want to use label propagation, we use this as a standard pre-processing process. So I will show you some, two concrete examples of label propagation, right? So one is we use label propagation to do symptom expansion. So the disease we studied is congestive heart failure, which is, those are the different facts of congestive heart failure, which is a fairly prevalent disease that costs a lot of money in the States and also across the world. And a common way to diagnose congestive heart failure is this set of symptoms we call Framingham criteria. So in order to confirm this patient have CHF, So at least one major symptom and two minor symptoms needs to appear. So, but I mean, a lot of the times when these symptoms are appearing, it is already too late. We know, so for heart failure, so the damage your heart get is not reversible. So there is some need that to discover some other symptoms rather than this Framingham criteria, which could appear earlier to help us to diagnose CHF in the early stage so that proper intervention can be applied, right? So in order to discover that, so this resource we use is clinical notes. So the clinical notes could be, because all those symptoms are typically recorded in, I mean, unstructured part of EHR, which are the clinical notes. So clinical notes are excellent resources to conduct this kind of research. So we want to expand Framingham criteria. So the two questions is how to, I mean, we want to use this graph-based approach because we want to apply label propagation. So first is how to construct the graph. So basically how to capture the relations among the different symptoms extracted from the clinical notes. The second is how can you run label propagation to expand the symptoms, right? So this is a paper published on KDD 2012. So we have, this is an overall flow chart. Like you have the initial clinical notes and then you do symptom extraction and then you construct the symptom graph. And then on that graph, you have a set of the initial symptoms which are the seed or the nodes, the symptoms that have initial labels. And then you want to predict for the rest of the symptoms, which are the nodes, what is the probability that they could also be very highly indicative, right? So it is like those are initial labels. You want to propagate that over the entire graph. And then you got the expanded symptoms. So label propagation will be here. Right, so that's the whole process. And the clinical note, this is a SOAP structure, which includes subjective, objective, assessment plan. So which are the different parts of the clinical note. And we use UEMA, which is a software, natural language processing software developed by IBM that is widely used in the natural language processing. So this is a process on how we have dedicated person helping us annotate the free clinical note, right? Which is not an easy process because you can think of, I mean, you have, first you need to specify, I mean, what are the potentially interesting symptoms? Second, you need to handle those modifiers, let's say a fever is an interesting term, but you could have a no before that. So this person, instead of this person have fever, but it says this person doesn't have fever. So those negations or modifiers would be very difficult to handle. But let's say this part has been done. So then we have got a set of symptoms, and then the next step is to construct the graph. We have the nodes now, right? The second step is to have the edges. So the edges, in this work, they just compute that by looking at the co-occurrence frequency of the pair of symptoms within the same clinical node, right? And the weight on the edge will be higher if they are more frequently co-occurred in the same clinical text. And then we did some normalization, then you basically have this graph. And on this graph, you have some, these are the Framingham symptoms, which are the seed, right? Which is like, you have initial label, here is one, you cannot see here, but here is one, the rest are the zeros. So you run label propagation on this graph, and then after converge, the value on those nodes will be the predicted importance or how likely these symptoms could be complementary to the Framingham symptom, right? Could be important. So that's the idea. And they evaluated this study on a data set of 1 million encounters of 13,000 patients. And there are a lot of, there are approximately 4.6 thousand patients diagnosed with CHF, okay? And they use some information retrieval related performance measure to evaluate whether this expanded symptoms or are valid or no. They also ask some expert to judge. So can you tell me whether, do you think this symptom is a valid symptom to early diagnose CHF or no? So they computed this. I mean, this is different ways of computing the weight on the edges of that symptom graph. So this is purely based on co-occurrence frequency. This is 0, 1, they co-occur or no. This is not only consider the frequency, but also the location of the two symptoms. So closer means they're more similar. So the further apart, the less similar they are, something like that. And these are the different performance measures. And so this is the top 10 relevant symptoms. So you can see chest pain, dyspnea, diabetes, obesity, those are the common comorbidities, hyperlipidemia, they are closely related to heart failure, of course. So that is one work. I think their paper, I mean, I'm not part of this work, but they published a paper in KDD 2012, and later on they published another paper on cardiac failure. So they present this to the cardiologist, and they picked up some interesting symptom, and did some study and published on a medical journal. So this is also one successful application of data mining techniques to medical problems. So that's a first example. Second example, in this example, we just have a set of symptoms as a graph, and then you do standard label propagation on top of that to expand the symptoms. But sometimes you're gonna have heterogeneous type of nodes in your graph, like in bipartite graph, what you can do, right? So we give another example in personalized treatment recommendation. So here, I mean, precision medicine, right treatment, right person, we typically also add right time, but in this work, we did not consider.
I have a question about
the
previous one. So is the invariance
of any can you say that again? I cannot hear clearly. You mean early stop or? The order of the input. No, it doesn't matter because the input is in terms of vector. There is no order.
So even in the top symptoms that you give, the input symptoms
still. It's equally important, right? We did not discriminate that. Yep. General prediction, yes, of course. Yeah, it is a transductive prediction type of thing. So you have a set of data samples and a small portion of them, you know the label, what is, right? It's a general setting, yeah.
So it seems that this label computation depends on the choice of these parameters of the weights. So how these weights, any procedure for these weights recovered?
The weights, right? So in this work, I mean these are the specific ways of computing the weights, but in general setting, the most popular way is still the Gaussian function. But the Gaussian function, it is sensitive to that sigma. So you can use local scaling. And I have a paper in ICML 2006. I learned those ways by solving local optimization problem. I assume that each node can be reconstructed from the neighborhood, and the reconstruction weights are served as similarities, so as the weights. So that's more automatic way instead of tuning that sigma. Yeah. Uh-huh. Other questions? The ordering, no, because it's, I mean, actually, there's no like, how to say that? I mean, you can see it does not like you first label this, then your second label that. It is initially those nodes have labels. The rest of the nodes doesn't have labels. You can use that equation that includes the matrix inverse to compute what is the convergent solution in one step, right?
Mm-hmm.
I think that's a good point. I think it might be a problem if you do a distributed version. And if you want to merge the result, it's that asynchronous updating. But I did not track that. I know there are works out there. Yeah, maybe you can check. Yeah. Yeah, that's no questions, right? OK. So in the second example, we do this recommendation of the treatment to the patients, right? So we have a set of patients, we have a set of drugs, and our goal is to generate hypothesis whether this drug can treat that patient. So we first construct a network, similarity network for the patients. We just use the diagnosis code over a certain time period, and we compute the Jaccard index between the set of diagnosis between the pairwise patients at the similarity measure. And we have a similarity among the drugs. So we have the drug similarity network. And we also have patient-drug associations. How this is obtained is basically for every drug, you have the therapeutic indication, which is what disease this drug is designed to treat. And for every patient, you have the ICD-9 code, right? What disease this patient has. So you can match both diseases. The drug therapeutic indication and the patient the ICD-9 code to get the association. And we want to do label propagation. And for this, this is not a bipartite graph, right? Because we have links within patient and within drugs. If you don't have links, you just have link across patient and drug, that is a bipartite graph. But this one is not. So basically, we want to do label propagation on top of this graph. We treat patient and drug equally. So we have 7 patients, 6 drugs. We compute 13 by 13 adjacency matrix. So if you arrange the patient together, drugs together, you can basically come up with this matrix as this part is the patient similarity, this part is the drug similarity, and these parts are basically patient-drug associations. So similarity computation I have already introduced. So every patient, you have a set of ICD-9 code, and you can compute the Jaccard index between them as the similarity. And for drugs, the same. I mean, every drug have a set of chemical structures, and you can compute the Jaccard index. Or in terms of protein targets, you can use the Smith-Waterman alignment score to compute that. And patient-drug associations, again, I mean, for every patient, you have a set of ICD-9 code. For drug, you have a set of therapeutic indications. You can compute that. And then we have the adjacency matrix. You do stochastication, you can use that to propagate labels. Now, what are the labels, right? So, I mean, because this is over the entire graphs on the top part, that is easy to understand. So basically, if I know this drug is effectively treating this patient, then my goal is to predict whether this drug can treat this patient and this patient, right? So I mean, if I know, I mean, then I have a one there. If I don't know, I mean, I want to predict that. So that is clear. So the problem is, what does this part mean? So basically, we interpret that as if this drug is this drug itself, it is in the network, then you have a one there. And for the rest are the zeros, and after propagation, it is like, for this data under this specific condition, so what is the similarity of this drug and this drug? It is very context specific. It is not like this part. So this part is very general. So you compute the similarity from drug chemical structure, from protein target. I mean, it doesn't matter it is for which disease condition, but here, this similarity is very specific. So under this specific context, treating this disease, what is the similarity between this drug and this drug? Okay, so that's how we interpret that. And this is the data set we use. So these are the databases we use to compute the drug similarity. And for the patient similarity, we use, I come up with a set of hyperlipidemia patient cohort, including 1,000 patients over 3 years of electronic health records. And we studied different kinds of statin drugs to treat those patients. And this is our study design. So initially, those patients, their LDL value are all above 130. So this is a hyperlipidemia patient cohort. And we take out the patient who take more than one drugs, because if he or she takes more than one drugs, it will be very hard to tell which drug is effective, or it is because of the drug combination. So we only pick the patients who just take a single drug, single type of drug. And then we check, because they repeatedly take LDL tests, if for two consecutive LDL tests, their LDL value is below 130, because before they take the drug, their LDL value is always above 130. After they take that, it is below 130. Then, which means that the drug is taking effect. And so let's say this is a first LDL test within that two consecutive tests, and then the drug effect, I mean, our domain expert tells us it's typically within 60 days, so we set a 60 days window. And let's say this is the first time this patient takes this drug, and then we use the 90-day window before that to extract the patient features so that this can guarantee, for the feature extraction period, the patient did not take any drug. And we want to predict, I mean, whether this drug will be effective or no. So that's the design. And this is the performance. We plot the ROC curve. So we did some comparisons, like because in this work, we leverage both patient and drug similarity. But clearly, you don't need drug similarity, right? You can directly propagate the label on the patient network, right? So that this is a performance. If you don't incorporate drug information. So this is the bottom two are you incorporate the drug information using different sources, structure information or target information. So we can see some performance improvement, which means that leveraging the drug information is useful, right? So this is another example on application of label propagation techniques to solve medical problems. Any questions on this? Yes, of course, you can formulate that as, let's say, a multi-task prediction problem. Each drug is a task, and then you build multiple predictors. Yes, there are multiple ways of doing this. A collaborative, yes, because this is intrinsically a CF problem, right? And label propagation can be used, page ranks, those kind of things are actually very similar. So this is like a collaborative filtering type of stuff. Yeah.
My question is, did you try other approaches? Label propagation?
Right, so for this work, we did not. We just used label propagation because that is very straightforward, but I mean, this is another reason why we did not dig this work further is because of the limitation of the data. Actually, this data is very noisy, and I mean, we think it is not worthwhile to work on this. But methodology-wise, I completely agree with you. I mean, we do want to try multitask learning or matrix factorization, those collaborative filtering type of stuff. But maybe when we get a better kinds of data, we will do this. Yeah. Can you repeat?
Instead of using the ICD codes for
that, uh-huh.
codes, have you tried any natural language?
Yes, that's a good question. So for this data set, first, we don't have free clinical text. We just have the structured part of the EHR.
Why
Huh?
Why do you have a structured part?
I mean, this is data we received from the one of the medical groups. I mean, they don't give us the free text, right? And another part, so in this work, we just use the diagnosis code, but of course, we can also use procedure code and other things in the structure part. Yeah.
My question is based on the fact that many times ICD codes are not accurately
presented. Right. I agree, yeah. Oh, yes, I can tell you my experience, right? So I have experience working on a lot of different kinds of version of EHR. So I can tell you, for example, the data I received from Vanderbilt is very good. Dense, regular, and Columbia is very good, because they use that for research for many, many years. And I mean, they have already done the cleaning. I mean, it's a time-consuming process. So the more you work on it, the better it will become, because, I mean, the people doing research, they know how to clean that, what they need. But this data is from a medical group, several hospitals, so it hasn't been used in any research before. So the quality, I mean, if you work on it, you can see, for example, a lot of this, I mean, mismatch. And also, for example, absurd values and a lot of missing and something like that. Yeah, that's what I mean, the quality. Yeah, quality is a big issue when you work with EHR. Yeah.
Were you looking at this
For this, no, because we receive everything as a whole. I mean, it's not like we receive different hospitals and aggregate them. No, they aggregate them, and they send us a big flat table, something like that. Yeah. Uh-huh.
Have you tried cases where you have, or studies where you have multiple components of medications? So, particular drug type?
Statins. I think for this, no. We just tried. I mean, while you're asking, I'm thinking of. Have we worked on other disease with different drug types? But I think we have that abstract for a brain cancer, chemotherapy drugs and non-chemotherapy drugs, right? So I mean the approach is general, yeah.
Okay.
Yes. Yes. I think for this specific study is because this problem is not proposed by us, it's proposed by our medical doctor. So he is interested in investigating those different kinds of statins. So who could be responsible or more effective for what, right? So that's why we studied this, yeah. Other questions? Uh-huh.
So do you suggest how to combine it? Yes,
that's a good question. I mean, I didn't show this, but I mean, we have worked on work it in a multiple kernel way. So you do a linear combination and you optimize the combination coefficients. And of course, if you know multiple kernel learning, you can also do nonlinear combination, but the interpretability would be a problem. So, I mean, you can do whatever you want. Okay, so the last part is factorization, matrix factorization. So I worked on matrix factorization a lot. I think I gave like 4 or 5 tutorials specifically on matrix factorization in CIKM, ICDM, SDM. I'm going to give you some examples of how these can be applied in healthcare problems. So this is my view on all of the matrix factorization problems. So typically, you can formulate that as a optimization problem. So you want to factorize this X into the product of a series of matrices, not necessarily 2. It can be 3 or 4 or 5 or 6, OK? So I saw a paper, factorize X into the product of 5 matrices. OK? Different matrix can have different interpretations. And then you this is your loss, approximation loss. And this is your regularizations. So basically, for each of the factorized matrices, you want it to have, let's say, sparse, generalizable. Sparse is 1 norm, generalizable 2 norm. Or you want it to have conform with certain type of geometric structure, let's say tree structure. You can impose a tree-based norm or rank. You want it to be low rank, you can have a nuclear norm and so on and so forth, right? And then sometimes you also have a set of constraints. For example, it can be non-negative. It can be satisfying some certain inequalities or something like that. So you can check. I mean, there could be tens of thousands of matrix factorization papers, and I think most of them would be from this. You can see it from this perspective. And so 2 most popular matrix factorizations. So 1 is low rank, this which we saw most frequently, right? So you have a matrix, and you want to approximate it with the product of a set of low rank matrices. The other one is this sparse. So the goal is that it's like a sparse coding type of stuff. What you want is interpretability, right? For here, you can also make the model simpler. You do dimensionality reduction, right? And non-negative matrix factorization is, of course, one of the most popular strategies. And this is a famous figure from Li and Song's Nature paper in 1999. They also have a NIPS paper. And so basically, what they did is that they want to use a set of face images. They first stretch every image into a column vector, and then concatenate all the images, then you form a vector X, and you want to factorize X into the product of 2 matrices, 1 is F, 1 is G. So they interpret F as the these things, these are the base images, okay? And the G as the combination coefficients. And they replot the F because initially you stretch X into vectors, so F is also in vectors. You can reformat F as a square matrices, then you can plot the image. The image is like that. So you can see clearly there are parts based representations. There are nose, there are hairs, eyes, those kind of things, which PCA type of stuff cannot produce. So part of the reason is because they require both F and G to be non-negative, which means that when you do the combination, you can do only do addition. There won't be any cancellations, right? So it will make the result more interpretable. And we have some works, for example, this is, if you remember my initial representation of EHR as a matrix. So this is feature, this is time, and we want to factorize this matrix as one is a feature grouping, or we call it every feature group as a latent medical concept. So latent medical concept, a mapping matrix, and the concept of value evolution matrix, right? So it is like, this matrix groups the roles into different feature groups. And this is basically the value of each feature group evolve over time. And we add up different kinds of constraints. We want it, the concept to be sparse. We want it to be stable. And we want the value to be smooth over time, something like that. And then we formulate that as a factorization problem. And we solve that. This formulation, so every patient works on its own. So we didn't consider the correlation among patients, which may cause the problem that if certain patients' initial matrix is too sparse, then basically you don't have too many information when you do the factorization. So this might be a problem. So later on, we extend it to a shared basis. So we assume we have a set of homogeneous patient cohort, and those homogeneous means that this patient share the same set of medical concepts, so they share the same U, and we solve a coupled matrix factorization problem. And but the problem is, how do you know which patient should belong to the same cohort, right? So, and then the third is like the cluster basis approach. So we group the patient into homogeneous cohort, and then for each homogeneous cohort, we assume it shares the same U matrix, right? And we solve for this clustering and factorization simultaneously. So this is a KDD paper in 2014. And then, so this factorization process is like, we factorize every patient EHR matrix as a product of two matrices, and you can use that product of two matrices as the densified version of your initial matrix, right? EHR matrix. So we can use this as a imputation process for pre-processing the sparse EHR matrix, and then do whatever prediction following on. We can compare, what if we do this densification or we don't do this densification, what is the difference? So we use it in a concrete scenario of early prediction of congestive heart failure. So this is the individual basis approach, shared basis approach, cluster basis approach with number of clusters set to 2, 3, 5. And these are the baselines. What if we just impute, we don't do impute, any imputation means that we just set the missings as zeros. We do raw average. We carry, last occurrence carry forward, next occurrence carry backward, and we do a linear interpolation between previous and next occurrence, something like that. So it's some basic statistical imputation approaches. So we can see that our approaches achieve a better performance. And you may want to ask me, how do I set number of clusters? I don't have an answer. So basically, we tune this, and typically, we first consult our medical doctor. So for this disease, how many potential subtypes it could have? And then that could be a good initial value, and then we tune the number of clusters around that. So, and those are the learned medical concepts, because the medical concepts are aggregated from the raw features. In this case, we use a diagnosis code. So we can see this is a medical concept related to cardiovascular disease, hypertension, so on and so forth. This is respiratory disease, pulmonary disease, which is common comorbidity of heart failure. And this is renal or diabetes. Yep. Which one?
The one you've got multiple metrics.
This one?
Yeah. Which to me is more like you actually got a several tensor. Have you tried to like compare with the tensor?
You know what is the problem of tensor? So for here, every matrix have different size. Every patient have different length. Okay, this patient I have 2 years of records because you know, right? So it's very hard to align. You can think of, or maybe you know, if you know better approaches, you can teach me. I don't know how to align them. I mean, actually, me myself also work on that. We do some disease progression modeling. We hope to use some latent variable models to match. So out from the observed EHR, what could be the latent stage this patient is in, and use that latent stage to do the alignment. But I can tell you, alignment is a very hard problem. If you can do alignment very good, I mean, you solve a lot of problems. Yeah. Yes, for this we just do a simple alignment, which is basically their diagnosis state, and then go retrospectively, hold off a prediction period from that. We need to align at a certain time, certain timestamp. Yes, for here exactly like you said. So in your case, it's hospital admission day. Here we just use the CHF diagnosis day. Yeah, because we want to predict the CHF. All right, so this is one work, and we also have some work I mentioned. I mean, this is low rank. We also have dictionary learning, so you want to learn a set of bases, like NMF, right? You want to learn a set of bases, and you want a sparse reconstruction. So this is, if you work on computer vision, I mean, those people want to learn the visual basis of the images. They use this kind of thing a lot. They call a sparse coding or dictionary learning. And there is also a group sparse coding, which, I mean, you assume, I mean, the data falls into different groups. The data within the same group, they share, I mean, for different groups, they share a certain part of common dictionaries, and they also have their own individual group of dictionaries, and how can we learn them both? So this is one work we did. Published in AAAI 2011. So how can we learn basically group specific? This is shared basis. This is individual group specific features and solve for them simultaneously, right? And I think another work is you remember, I mean, what I gave here are mostly, I factorize the matrix as a set of product, as a product of a set of matrices, but that product can also change. So in this example, as we want to detect the temporal patterns, in these matrices, which is basically the sub-matrices that repeat. So let's say this, it's a pattern because it repeats also here. This is a pattern because it also repeats here. This pattern could be very indicative of a certain condition, right? So we create a convolution operator. So we call it one-side convolution. So if you have a pattern here and you want it to appear here, here, and here, you just place it here, here, and here, and then you do a superposition, and then you got this patient matrix. Now what we want is a reverse way, right? This is what we have, and we want to detect those, and also their appear locations, right? So this is our formulation. So this is the approximation cost, and these are the patterns, let's see, we want to solve, and these are the locations. And this is a number of patterns. And so here, this is no longer a matrix product, but this is one-side convolution, and this is some sort of matrix loss. We use beta divergence in this This is basically when you compute the loss for the zeros, which are the missing, you don't want to compute the loss. You just want to compute the loss on non-zero entries, right? These are the different kinds of regularizers. And this is a paper in KDD 2012. We do this. So the point I want to show it here is I want to claim that, when you do the factorization, this also can be generalized to other type of not constrained to matrix product, but other type of matrix operations. So yeah, we developed some rules to do that, and this is a synthetic example. So we have these matrices, and those four are the patterns, and we run that. And because initially we don't know the number of patterns, so we set it to 10, and this is a pattern we detected. So the first four are the four patterns, and the rest of six are all zeros. And then, so the next question is, how can we utilize that? So we count the number of times each pattern appears in each matrices, and we come up with this bag of pattern representation, and we concatenate this bag of pattern representation with a bag of feature representation to see, by incorporating those bag of pattern representation, the prediction performance can be improved or not. So it seems that if the static is the bag of feature representation. This temporal plus static is, we use both bag of feature and bag of pattern. So we can see a general trend. So this is different events we use to investigate this. But it doesn't matter you use which one, or we always see a performance improvement. And when you use all of them, you can see the best of performance. So which means that this can be better. When you incorporate those patterns as features. So the last one I want to introduce briefly is, it's still a KDD paper in last year. So, yeah. Yeah. Right, sequence. Actually, here, how far they're apart is encoded, because I represent that as matrix, right? How far they're apart is encoded in this matrix, right? Because the horizontal axis is time. Yeah. Uh-huh. Okay. Uh-huh. Yes. I mean, for this data set, of course. Yeah. Right. Right. Yeah. This is a early prediction of heart failure. Yeah. For this case, it's half a year. Yeah, 6 months. Yes, we have a simplified version. So instead of doing that in matrices, we use the database type of approach. So do a sequential pattern mining and use the pattern as a, yes, we also have some a simplified version of that. Yeah. But for that, you know, the problem is the pattern explosion. So that, if you know that, I mean, the threshold is very tricky to set. If you set the threshold, the support threshold to be a small value, so you pop up with tens of thousands of patterns. But if you set it to be a very large value, so all the patterns are not discriminative. So that's a problem. But here we use approximation, so the patterns are not exact, but it's an approximation, so you can control the number of patterns. Yeah. Or reduce. So basically, we set it to be 2 year, 1 year, 1.5 year, half year. Yeah, that's what we set. And the longer the prediction window, the worse the prediction performance. Yeah. Yes. Right. I mean, we set it to half year because it is proposed by, I mean, the medical doctors. Yeah. The timestamp. So in this case, it's just, when we receive the data, the finest resolution is per day. So it's per day. Yeah. So every day, I mean, there is a column. OK, so I think we're already out of time. So the last thing I want to show here is another work. We want to detect the patterns also using matrix factorization. So because of the pattern explosion problem, so we want to, instead of representing the EHR as sequences, we represent that as a directed graph. And the events in the graph are the events in the EHR, and the direction are the temporal directions, which one, I mean, let's say this one happens first, this one happens second. And the thickness of the edge or the weights on the edge is basically some exponential function of the time duration. So this graph can be translated to this graph, provided there is some certain gap, which means that, let's say, if in this case the gap is 3 months, which means that, let's say, C and D, there's 4 months between them. There's, it is meaningless to dig out the sequentiality pattern between them because the gap is too long. It's basically two episodes. So, I mean, if it is larger than this gap, we don't put any edge on that. So you can translate the sequence into a directed graph, and then the temporal patterns will become, because we have a whole bunch of directed graphs, the temporal patterns will be subgraphs, a frequent subgraph in those directed graphs, and we detect those subgraphs by this matrix factorization. So because every graph is corresponding to a adjacency matrix, we assume it is a linear combination of the set of base graphs. This B is a base graph, A is a combination coefficient, and we minimize certain loss here. We just use the Euclidean loss, and we added some regularizer. For example, if we know some similarity, patient similarity beforehand, we want, this is basically this A, the combination coefficient, is like the embedding of the EHR into this graph space, right? It is another representation, and you impose some smoothness constraint on this representation, and also if you have labels on certain portion of patients, you can also use this A as the new representation to do the prediction, and you can also add some prediction loss. And this is a example. This is an initial graph generated by random combination of those bases, and this is the basis we discovered, and this is still in that task. So what if we use static features, sequential pattern mining, the features from sequential pattern mining, the matrix features I just talked about. This is basically using the graph features with no regularizer, similarity-based regularizer, largest loss and hinge loss when we do the prediction. So the similarity becomes worse. I think one reason is because we don't have ground truth similarities. We just, artificially compute certain type of, a certain kind of patient similarities and to show the effect of that to the final result. So that quality may not be good because we don't have ground truth, not like this. We have ground truth, so it performs better. And these are the examples of the discovered graph patterns. So for example, here you can see there are three hops. One is nutrition disorders, complications, hypertension. Hypertension is clearly related to heart failure, and nutritional disorder and complications are fairly general. So this is a single hop pattern, which is heart arrhythmia, which is closely related to heart failure. You can see the patterns are fairly messy. So one reason is because we don't add any regularizer on B. We just add regularizer on A. So one of the work we are currently working on is add some structured penalty on B to make this graph cleaner. So I think that's all I want to talk about. I think we ask questions during I talk, and for the sake of time, if you have questions, you can we can communicate offline, or you can send me email. The last thing I want to do is that I'm looking for a postdoc. So we are in a wonderful place. So if you're interested, or anyone you know who are interested, so please ask him to contact me.